Hi everyone, welcome to Alarmel Valley's YouTube channel. My name is Akhila Krishnamurthy. I'm an independent journalist and I've had the privilege of interviewing Alarmel Valley, I don't know, right from the time I began my career as a journalist, which is almost more than 20 years ago. I have to say at this point that every time I interview her, I go back home feeling super energized and inspired. You know, this is what I think the privilege of my profession is, that we get to live life vicariously. Thank you, Valli, yet again for inviting me to be in conversation with you as part of your social media series, Co-Travelers in My Artistic Journey, where Alarmel Valli attempts to really document and recognize all the people who've played a crucial role in her journey, in her career as a dancer. In this particular episode, we're going to be speaking with Valli about her masters, Pandanallur Sri Chokkalingam Pillai and Pandanallur Sri Subbaraya Pillai. And Valli will really shed the spotlight on not just how genius they were as teachers, but also how they really allowed you to find your own voice. And this is also our attempt to really celebrate, Valli, I always think about your sort of singular commitment to a life in dance. So, and I know that your masters have played such an important role in that. Yeah. So, thank you for giving me this opportunity to speak with you about your masters.
Thank you. It's not a question of you say something nice and I'm going to say something nice, but I have to say that talking to you, and I have, as you said, we've been having conversations for since you were maybe your 20s.
In my 20s, yeah.
So it's always such a relief to talk to someone whom you feel empathizes. And I think you have, even when you were very young, you understood my background, where I was coming from and what my ideals were. So that helps a great deal. So thank you for helping me do, you know, reach out and
fantastic.
Speak about my master's.
Privilege is entirely mine, Valli.
Question mark.
Okay, so this is about you, Valli. So now I'm going to firstly ask you this word co-travelers. You know, why do you think your masters really feature almost amongst, you know, the top of that list in that co-travelers?
No matter how talented you are, Akhila, no matter how gifted, how hardworking, how passionate, your talent would be like a stream without boundaries. It would become a stream in spate, a river in spate, without, and this is my view, without good gurus. And I really feel that finding a good guru in life, whether it is a philosophical guru or a guru in any field, any discipline, is a blessing. It is something to do with our past karma. Unless you have done a great deal of good in your past,
absolutely,
I don't think we merit such people. And these masters, we're going to speak about that, I'm sure, but to answer, why are they right at the top? Because without them, I wouldn't be the dancer I am. Without the language that they gave me, to a great extent, because that language is so rich, the vocabulary is so rich, the grammar is so beautifully structured, that when you have the gift of a language which they give you, which they transmit to you, then I think you can aspire to be a poet, which is something close to my heart.
Absolutely.
So much of what I am,
for sure,
is because of these masters who put my feet there on that path, on that journey. They're not just co-travelers, they're my guides. I can't call them co-travelers.
Absolutely, yeah.
They are my guides, my mentors, and those who with love have given generously and wholeheartedly.
Absolutely.
These masters from that great heritage, you know, they've had a reputation for keeping their secrets to themselves. That is not true of my masters. Both Chokkalingam Pillai sir, Pandanallur Chokkalingam Pillai sir, and his son Subbaraya Pillai sir in particular, under whom I studied for so many years, he gave with handfuls. He gave me in spades. He gave me so much.
Fantastic. Well, it's so beautiful you use this word language, right? Mm-hmm. And, you know, today, even after more than 5 decades of career, of dancing career, you continue. Nearly 6 decades. You continue to explore, discover, feel that sense of wonderment, right? That comes with. Yeah, I think that's the beauty of great masters, right?
Yes, to a great extent, because they teach in such a way that there is no ennui, no boredom. And they also give you that language. I'll speak of Subraya Pillai because Chokalingam Pillai said passed away. After 4 years, we will be speaking about him, I hope.
Yes.
Of what he gave specifically. But Subraya Pillai sir gave me, I always say, a strong foundation. And then the freedom to be my own dancer. So that it's not by rote. You're not in a straight jacket of tradition, of an ancient idiom, of a stylized idiom. Arundhati Subramanian, my dear friend and eminent poet, she often says that the challenge for the classical dancer is to take this ancient stylized idiom and make it an evergreen language. And it was thanks to these, the attitude of these masters to allow me, to, first to give me the language, and then allow me to explore and to experiment. So if you want the processes, I can speak about them. But
absolutely, we will be getting to that soon. But I wanted to start off actually, firstly, by asking you, do you remember, you know, what is your, what are your earliest memories of your gurus? Do you remember your first day in dance class,
for example? Yes, I in fact remember the kurta. They told my mother, I have to wear a short tunic with salwars. And I still remember, don't ask me why, these some memories when so much is fading away, some memories stay vivid in the mind. And I was wearing, those days we had voile. Rubia voile or whatever it was. And it had a very delicate linear pattern in dark or a kind of green and black. And I was wearing that kurta to my first class.
Wow. And how old were you, Valli?
6. That's why it's astonishing. It must have had made a very great impact on me. The fact that I remember even what I wore that day.
Absolutely.
I was crony. I was painfully thin, and I was always, you know,
a tomboy.
I was not a tomboy, but I would flit around waving my hands. My cousin was a tomboy.
Okay,
I was the weakling in the family.
Right.
So
yeah, you've talked about this.
Amma, since she saw something in me, that is my mother's greatness, was her greatness. She took me to masters who were already teaching cousins. And there was this old Chokalingam Pillai sir, you know, in those days, and he had this crew cut, I remember, cut close, sitting there with his long walking stick. And even then, without saying anything, he was a formidable figure. And next to him was Subraya Pillai sir.
Okay.
A much more, a gentler personality.
Okay.
And Amma took me there and he first made me do my tattadavu, obviously, first thing. And I remember him looking at my feet, and that's a very strange thing because most people look at my feet, I have low arches. And there was one Dutchman, I remember, who saw me dance at the Tropen Museum in Holland, and who came up and said, I'm a doctor, I don't know how you're dancing, and you flit across the stage, and you just, how do you do it with nearly flat feet? So, but Master said the opposite. He said, avalukku nanna varum. Dance nanna varum. He saw me and then he said, kaal oru avala ka andha kaal nalla kaal dance ku.
Wow.
He told my mother that. So she was very thrilled.
Right.
And after that, in this old corporation school, which I have spoken about, which was not aesthetic, you know, you think these days that we have to have, we all do
everything
that,
is,
create a beautiful aesthetic space. Around space. But I think a space in itself the space is meaningless. Mm. It is the energy that charges that space.
Mm. Absolutely.
It is how that space is inhabited. And by whom it is inhabited, mm. that makes such a difference. And absolutely. These two masters, they really embodied the sacred spirit of this dance. And in, you know, used to have, he'd be teaching takadimi, takadimi, or takita, takita, nadai, something. Mm. And there'd be this train going by takadimi, takajuno, takadimi, you know,
yeah.
chik, 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 chik. And sometimes we'd go off beat even.
Right.
So, and they were pitted floors, so we danced around them.
Mm.
But I remember those days in Egmore at the Corporation Institute, a school, as some of the most enriching is a mild word, but the days which, if you're talking of journeys, gave me the best start. Mm. on my dance journey.
Fantastic.
And my mother would sit in front, masters would be there. They had a soft spot for me. Even Periyavadhyar, as we called him, was always very kind.
Mm.
You know, they would not pull me up if I made a mistake. Should I say this?
Yes, of course.
That, you know, master would let me off. My mother would be looking daggers at me, one little mistake. And then I'd say, Vadhyare Chalalama, Chinna Tappudane, and the Jatiswaratla, Chinna Tappudane. She says, Chinna Tappile. When you go on the floor, it is your puja. Pujiyani, you cannot afford to be careless about it.
Absolutely.
So I had the best of both, you know, a very strict person to pull me up, and masters who gave and gave. But I was very respectful.
That's
we
what I was
had
going
such to. Reverence for these masters. பெரியவாதியரெல்லாம் கண்டா பயப்படுவோம்.
வள்ளி, ஹவு டிட் தே இவோக் தட் சென்ஸ் ஆஃப் ரிவரன்ஸ்? ஐம் ஆல்வேஸ் சோ க்யூரியஸ் பிகாஸ் வி லிவ் இன் அ வேர்ல்ட் வேர் யூ நோ இட் இஸ் வெரி டிஃபிகல்ட்.
கேஷுவல்னஸ்,
யா, தெர் இஸ் அ சென்ஸ் ஆஃப் கேஷுவல்னஸ் ஆல்சோ, தெர் இஸ் அ கிரேட் சென்ஸ் ஆஃப் என்டைட்டில்மெண்ட். சோ ஐ எம் ஜஸ்ட் க்யூரியஸ் அபவுட் ஹவு தே மேனேஜ் டு டூ இட் அண்ட் சோ லைக் ஈஸிலி, ரைட்? சோ கேஷுவலி, இட் வாஸ் நாட் சம்திங் ஸ்டடீட்.
நோ, இட் வாஸ் நாட்.
இட்ஸ் வெரி ஆர்கானிக், ரைட்?
இட் வாஸ், இட் வாஸ் ஆர்கானிக். Okay, we have to admit that times have changed. Mm. We have Gen Z and we have a whole different way of thinking, a different approach to life.
For sure.
Which has been largely influenced, in the case of India, I think, by the West.
Of course.
It's America in particular.
Yeah.
So, there is this thing of, you know, nonchalance, a sense of, what is this thing about reverence? Mm. Why should we have reverence for these people?
Mm.
We are equals in a sense. Mm. They are giving me something, I'm taking it. But it was not, and I'm happy to say that to this day, the dance world, there is that respect.
That sense of,
to
yeah.
a great extent it is.
Compared to other industries,
yes,
right?
Yes,
like,
yes.
I mean, if I were to
other,
use that,
yes, yes.
professions.
Certainly, dance students have, I think, at least my experience
Absolutely.
Has been wonderful, the
yeah.
kind of
yeah.
Respect. But then it depends. Everything depends on the guru.
Mm.
On, because these masters were repositories of the cultural heritage of centuries of knowledge.
Mm.
And when you have someone like that, and I think it's true of all teachers, even in college, there were some lecturers in whose classes we would vie to sit in the front row.
Of course.
And there was, oh, no nonsense, no, you know, whispering,
yeah, yeah.
all this. Others, it would be much more casual. So, when you are in the presence of greatness, and I'm saying this even of Kelucharan Mahapatra ji, Guru Kelucharan Mahapatra, when you, Muktama, who, all those my gurus who have taught me, masters, you didn't play the fool with them, because they had no patience for people who were not totally committed.
Mm.
Not committed. So, when you are in the presence of such people, even if you might, you know, later on as you grow older, you start thinking, oh, maybe, you know, I can do this like this.
Mm.
And that is where Subraya Pillai sir allowed me to experiment.
Mm.
He was never, no, this is the way and you have to do it that way.
Mm.
You can't move your eyes in any other way. You can't, of course, the adav is natyaramba, whatever it was,
sacrosanct,
had to be yeah. that way. But within the framework, mm. you could grow.
Right.
So these masters, I think even if they taught today, there would be that same mm. respect. I grant that that was an era when it came more easily mm. to us, that idea of maryade, mm. bhaya bhakti, mm. the word of reverence, mm. of mm. bhaya bhakti. Mm. So that might have changed, mm. but I think, you know, masters, mm. they did not care about money.
Mm.
They were not commercialized, and you knew you were there at their pleasure because they suffered you,
mm-hmm.
not the other way around. Mm. I was paying them a fee and mm. you're giving me something. It was not transactional.
Mm.
It was not. Mm. 10 rupees was our monthly salary.
Unbelievable.
So when that, and they would, if they felt you were disrespectful, mm. even not by word,
mm.
but by just something in your mm. attitude,
mm.
they would stop teaching you. That is it, no matter who you are,
wow.
who you were.
Yeah. But what about, that leads me to my next question, really about this idea of question, you mm. know, questioning.
Mm. Mm.
Like,
mm.
could you ask them questions? I'm just wondering, what was that world like?
Chinnavadhyar, that is my Guru Subraya Pillai, yes.
Okay.
Periyavadhyar, I was too young
yeah,
then.
Yeah, of course.
I had my Arangetram under him.
Of course.
Just 2.5 years down the line, that was unusual.
I know.
Mm. And 4 years later, but he came and saw me do, but I'll talk about that later.
Mm.
You asked me whether one could question. I never questioned him. I wouldn't dare presume okay. to question Periyavadhyar.
Okay.
But as I grew older, and I was in my late teens, and mm. when I was 15,
mm.
Subraya Pillai sir started introducing me mm. to the principles of choreography
mm.
in the Pandanallu tradition.
Mm.
He taught me about, you know, how to do kanak, how mm. to calculate mm. the structure
mm.
of that, how mm. to calculate the rhythmic mm. structures.
Mm.
And even in Tirmanam, Jatis, he would teach me mm. that. And then he would say, sir, he gave me this Shivanandan Pillai sir's, Veenai Shivanandan Pillai mm. sir's Tillana,
mm.
Hamsanandi
mm.
Tillana. And he said, choreograph it. And he guided me. He would say, yeah, we have spoken a lot mm. about Sarakku Minakku principles.
Course.
So he would just suggest, even that, he'd say, yeah, in that I vechirka. Then I'd say, oh, alaga irukku sir, nalla irukku paakradhukku. He says, paakradhu, what you see
hmm.
and what is attractive is important.
Hmm.
Ana adala minukadavuma, aarambikracha, when you start out with a particular sequence,
hmm.
these are the adavas which you must begin with in our style.
Hmm.
This is the body of it. Mm. This is the substance. That mm. is the sarak.
Mm.
So sarak should be predominant.
Mm.
And so he gave me all these aesthetic principles. Mm. They're not just, you know.
Right. Well, I want to ask you a little bit before we talk about your masters, a little bit about the Bani itself in mm. today's context,
mm.
the relevance of a Bani, the relevance of tradition, and what are some of the, you know, the characteristics of the Pandanallur Bani.
What can I say? It's like an ocean.
Mm-hmm.
But to begin with, I think they were very particular about linear purity,
mm.
the purity of lines.
Mm.
They had a vocabulary which was vast and rich.
Mm.
I remember even during choreography, he'd say, why are you repeating that again and again? So,
mm.
you know, you could go through an entire mm. sequence without repeating mm. the same alphabet.
Wow.
And they had a very rich alphabet. They believed in lyricism.
Mm.
I'm giving you general points.
Mm. Of course.
Lyricism more than drama, the dramatic mode, you know,
mm.
more of Natya Dharmi than Loka Dharmi. Mm. And in that, as I said, the expression had to be poetic.
Mm.
Subtlety
mm.
as opposed to being overt.
Mm.
Subtexts over what was obvious.
Mm.
I think that was a style, and it was also a style where, see, the natya, different styles have different stylistic variations. So I'm not going into technique.
Sure.
But you know, natyarambam for us was like this.
Teyum
tatta used to, I used to call it lever flip, you know, when I taught my students, because this, and I like to think all my students had that advantage of, you know, teyum tatta teyita, however fast.
Yeah.
Teyum tatta teyita. And there's another aspect which master, this I think was Periyavadhyar, Jogalingam Pillai sir's gift.
Mm.
You know, with all the censure that dance came in for and the dance world came in for, I think to make it acceptable, this is my reading, to a very puritanical society, they had perforce to edit, to edit. But, you know, when you try to bring purity, you start distilling. And the distilling process, if you're trying to remove crudity from dance and whatever that you feel has crept in, if you distill it of all fragrance, color, and flavor, then you end up with distilled dance. And our dance is full-blooded. It is sensuous. It is joyous. And that quality might have, I think it certainly did suffer in the interim period when there was so much of mudslinging going on. So, to make it acceptable to a more puritanical mindset, Western, British, dictated mindset, if you like, they had said, don't smile too much, don't do this. I think he felt it because he used to tell the students, Jadam Mariye Adre. Vittupidi. Jadam is a, you
means
know,
what,
Vali? Zombie.
Just for the, those who don't understand Tamil.
Jadam is the headless body.
Okay. Yeah.
You know, it's like a zombie, in other words. Don't dance like that expressionless way. Jadam Mari Adade. And he gets so angry, you know.
Right.
He'll do this at you. And another thing he was trying to do, and certainly because Pandanalu style, there was one criticism, which, oh, this is a great style, it's magnificent, it's like the Tanjore temple gopuram and vimanam and all that. But it is too rigid, it's too staccato, that's what they used to say. So he was, I think, these masters were highly intelligent and aware. So he, I think, was conscious of this. So he used to say, Thavalayapidi. Thavalayapidi means loosen up. But it was an extremely difficult principle. If you're aiming for a seamless quality, for a fluid line, what he was wanting was a fluid line.
Yeah.
You know, if you're doing, you know, or the body, the rigidity of the body, he would ask us to flow. And he, see, between this, this is absolutely correct.
Right.
But going up, and there again, I can feel the crispness. So there had to be crispness. But you know, if you're doing this, you're not breaking the line.
Correct.
But it's rolling out and rolling back. And we never understood. There was a lot of frustration amongst older dancers. There was one very fine dancer. She was perfect. Kachidam, which is perfection. She used to tell my mother, she's much older, and she'd say, I can't understand. He says, tighten here, loosen here, tighten here. I mean, what am I? I'm not a robot. How am I expected to do this? So, I remember for me, the aha moment, eureka happened with that which again I have spoken of, but I can't think. They used metaphors to teach. Mm. Their method of teaching was different. So this rolled feather attached to a whistle, you blew on it and the feather unfurls. So he would say, let your hands unfurl. Viriya vidu eriyada kaiya.
Wow.
So these were ways in which he was evolving the Pandanallur style. So what I present is the evolved Pandanallur style.
Fantastic. Well, it was like poetry in movement, right? Really being able to like...
study with them.
Yeah, study with them. Also, Bali, this process of this aha moment, right, also meant that you had to be extremely like present in class, right? I'm always like, you know, I'm always in awe of any, you know, student of dance who has to sort of, you know, it's not just an exchange, but also you are, you're in it, you're reflecting at the same time. Could you talk a little bit about this quality of introspection, which was also a very, very crucial part of the learning process?
Yes. Current day scenario for me particularly, who grew up at a time when it was pre-smartphones, pre-television, pre-internet.
Right.
The first thing in the morning when you wake up, you know, saying what messages have you received on WhatsApp? And then, you know, that takes something. I think, what am I doing? It's so distracting.
I know.
So times are very challenging.
Yeah.
But I grew up at a time, and thank God for that, the foundation was laid. My character was, to a great extent, it was forming at that point. And that's why it was so important, formative years, not to have these distractions, this cacophony of sound, of noise.
Absolutely.
So, immersion in class, you had to focus because he would not repeat.
Exactly.
There was no analysis of everything here, you know, we
or
analyzed.
Like a recorder, right? Like,
oh, yes. See, my students' parents, aka record pani. And nowadays, I'm not necessary record pani class because you think that will take them along easier and more easily. But those days, there was no way. So, you had to observe. You had to focus. You had to absorb. And then you had to introspect. That process of focus, absorption, introspection, concentration, and then reflection. This was automatic if you were serious about your dance, or if you had a mother like mine who made sure that I was not playing the fool.
Right.
So, I'd come home and I'd have to introspect and also reinforce the lessons of the day. So, that happened, and then that becomes a habit.
Habit, yeah.
It becomes a way of approaching learning. And for me, that is the best way, because today the mother used to talk about sacred commitment. And I've spoken about this, that monkey, they were my cousins making faces from a window at the back of master, and I lost my train of thought, and for that her admonition was, even if 100 monkeys dance in front of you, you can't let your mind dance like a monkey. Now, these masters never said that. Maybe not as strongly as my mother. But they would say, Arndh pare, Uttu pare, which means, you know, focus on what you're doing. Observe. And by virtue of the kind of people they were, you were automatically, because they taught almost by a process of osmosis. There was not this constant analysis. That was one reason. When you start analyzing everything, then you're not left with anything to analyze. You know, I do all kinds of things when I teach, and they learn it faster, but it doesn't happen. Because you have to, observation, I think, is vital for a dancer. observation of everything, of life, of nature around you. And this process of training teaches you to become more observant. And from that observation springs immersion and introspection. You start going deeper down. You're able to create those islands of stillness.
Absolutely.
The other thing is that my mother taught me to read.
Yeah, you've talked about this.
Not just taught me to read.
Yeah.
She inculcated in me a taste for books. Now, the roof could have fallen on me and I wouldn't have noticed. So that ability to immerse oneself into a book, that, you know, everything you did in life, there was not everything, but things you loved, the dance, books, music. So then there was that process whereby everything else faded away and you existed in that moment, you lived that moment, and it became a part of your subconscious.
Absolutely.
So that kind of immersive training, I think, is vital because it sparks off creativity. Rather than if every now and then I'm punching that button to see what YouTube is saying or Google is saying or something else is saying, that is distracting you. Why when you don't, you have a blank slate. And then you start, it is so much more challenging but more fulfilling than if you have this strong visual image which happens today. That also keeps you from going into yourself.
Absolutely.
You're going into someone else's dance.
Right.
Or ideas.
Right.
So I think that is a danger today, that we have to learn to pull our mind back and to learn to, you know, ideas need to percolate. They need to go deep down into one's subconscious and then they emerge as something very different.
Right. Well, I don't have, I've never had those moments of leisure, but I have to tell you this.
Yes.
Every time I listen to this story, I can, you know, also because you articulate so beautifully, I almost feel like I'm there. And that's why I said in the beginning that, you know, this is called living life vicariously. So thank you so much for that. Vali, I want to ask you a little bit about, you told me in the beginning that, you know, you spent, Sri Chokalingam Pillai taught you only for a few years. And a large part of your training was with Subbarai Pillai, sir. So could you tell us a little bit about how different and similar they were? And I also want to ask you a little bit about how did Subbarai Pillai sir really teach you this art of choreography? I think that would also be of great interest to, you know, dancers as well. So,
okay. Neither of them really analyzed or explained. But with Chokalingam Pillai sir, there was, as I said, a much greater bhaya bhakti. And I was too young at that point. He came home and he blessed me and he said, Purusha Urva. My mother, you know, was there also. And he had tears in his eyes. He said, because he was going away to the village. He died shortly. Because he had a stroke and he couldn't even articulate. He came and saw the Useni Swarajati. He wanted to come and see. He said, Kuttivalli. They carried him in a chair. And he saw that first half of the Swarajati which they were teaching me. Anyway, the point is that with him, there was no question of questioning or of, so his teaching, but as I said, he'd talk in metaphors when he explained this and he had names for us, Shundakai, Vendakai, and he said, Tovalayapudi, Jadom Mari Adade. Now that leaves strong images in your mind.
Absolutely.
Vittupudi, which Subbarai Pillai also used to say, Vittupudi, Vittupudi, you know, so he had ways of conveying the idea, but as I said, all of us looked at him with awe. With Vaathiyar, he was more like a father. He was much closer. He'd come home, he'd have lunch with us on weekends, and you know, when I had time, more time. And he had a lovely, gentle sense of humor.
Okay.
And so it was more, in a sense, intimate. I could talk to him. Then I'll ask him, sir, he'd tell me, let's say, ஒரு தீர்மானம், யூனோ சார் நம்ம தீர்மானம்லாம் ரொம்ப அழகாக இருக்குது சார், ஆனால் ரொம்ப சின்னதாக இருக்குது சார், கொஞ்சம் பெருசாக்கலாமா சார் ப்ளீஸ். ஸோ தென் சரி பண்ணு பண்ணி கொண்டு வந்து சொல்லி எனக்கு. ஸோ ஐ சார்ட் ஆஃப் எம்ப்ராய்டர் அரவுண்ட் தட் ஜதி
ரைட்
அண்ட் கம் அண்ட் ஷோ இட் டு ஹிம் அண்ட் ஹி வில் சே பார் இந்த ஹனுமான் பால் மாதிரி, யூனோ மீனிங் தட் ஐ கீப் பிரேக்கிங் டு டாமில், பட் டோன்ட் elongate something like Hanuman's tail. Why? You've said it 3 times. If you want to repeat, thirumba thirumba bore adikkavenda. But don't make that jati too long. And then if you want to repeat it, change the adavas. Change the alphabet that you use. Don't do the same thing, the side, that side, the third side. So he used to correct me like that. And choreography, as I said, he and Kittappa Pillai sir were closely connected, right? The family was,
of course,
Tanjore Kittappa Pillai.
Right.
So he has very often brought Kittappa Pillai sir home.
Oh.
If he happened to be choreographing something for me, he would bring Kittappa Pillai sir and they would sit there. Sir also would join us for lunch. And I remember one lesson particularly where they were discussing, you know, the thalam. Because there was a particularly complicated arudhi at the end and a korve in the end of one sequence of adavas, it ended with a particularly complicated flourish of three at the end. And it was, and also they had the habit of, they very important, never pre-compose to a certain number of avartanas and lift it onto the structure of the music.
Okay.
That was vitally important. Musicality was very important to them.
I was going to ask you a bit about.
Forgot to mention when I spoke about the style.
Style, the bani. That
it was a very musical style, not just lyrical, but musical. And master had a remarkable way of paadi to tattuvar, you know, he'd wield the tattukari, and sometimes, you know, the nadais would be totally different to what he was doing. But he would make sure that he would be, he would not adapt the music, but he would give stress at certain points. And that also, I think, also helped me as to this vallinam mellinam, light and shade in footwork. So he would say, don't keep thud, 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 making noise all the time. There should be சருக்கள் அங்கே வந்து தட்டு, யூ நோ பீட் ஹார்ட். ஸோ தேர் வாஸ் திஸ், தேர் வாஸ் அ விஸ்பர் அட் டைம், த ஃபுட் வுட் விஸ்பர் அட் டைம்ஸ், தட் பி அ ஷார்ப் சவுண்ட். ஸோ லைட் அண்ட் ஷேட், இட்ஸ் மியூசிக், ஹி வுட் சே.
ஃபண்டாஸ்டிக்,
ஹி செட் திஸ் இஸ் மியூசிக். ஸோ நீ யோர் சிங் ஃபீட் ஷுட் சிங். ஸோ வென் ஹி டாட் த அடவர்ஸ் அண்ட் ஹி சாங் அண்ட் ஹி டேப்ட், ஹி வாஸ் ஏபிள் டு டூ இட். இட் வெரி டிஃபிகல்ட் ஆக்சுவலி. Master used to have that skill. And when he taught choreography, these were things that I learned from him. Also with Kittappa Pillai, he was explaining, par, inga vandu varamatengudhu illa, this is not coming to beat. Then he calculated, he showed me how the calculations, Kittappa Pillai spoke about it.
Wow.
And how to calculate the kanakku after choreographing. Don't sculpt and then stick it onto that music, because the music has to flow. He'd say, make the music yours.
Yeah.
The music part modalla unakku utpadithiko modalla, make it yours.
Internalize.
Then you try to choreograph. This is one of the points that he always taught me. Don't, and that happens, you know, when you think you're doing something very complicated, trying to impress. No, I think the music should be the guide. It should be as much of the teacher. This is something which master, I think, guided me in the process. And in Abhinaya, it was so subtle, you know. They wouldn't focus, Mate, they left you to yourself, to you had to find your path.
Right.
But he would say, do that, just one slight curve of the eyes.
Right.
Then he'd say vittupudi, that and the uttapare, you know, lengthen the gaze. Don't keep shifting from side to side. So they give you valued points. And choreography, you asked me a point, you said how did he teach me, right?
Yeah.
As I said, as I was explaining, you know, these adavas or all these twirls that we see very constantly, or you know, curvaceous adavas, where the hands are moving in curves rather than linear lines. His feeling was saraka adavas are the ones which are like kudithu mette adavu. This tatteitaha, tatteitaha, tadinganatom, sutra adavu. Sutra adavu is vitally important. So, he, and I did one of my master's old, his choreography in Ragamalike Varnam. And I realized the number of sutra adavas and the use of Natyarabham. They would constantly retrace, you know, whether it's this, you know, the constant retracing of the Natyarabham. And today there's much more of focus on linear. Choreography has changed. The focus tends to be on more circular, linear.
Right.
He used to believe a lot in this linear position, the Natyarambham, which had to be teitaita. You had to come back each time to that. You know, not just leaps and curves, but where or this adavita, tatangita. These adavas. And they, you know, the movement of this hand when you're doing the, you know, that kind of
wow.
I think he used to say use these and stress. There has to be particular moments when you stress, light and shade. So as I said, it was not any fixed formula, routine, class as such. It was just by being with him, absorbing, listening to his metaphors that I learned.
And also being, I suppose, an equal and an involved participant, right? I mean, all of this would not have made sense to somebody who was not committed, like your mother said, sacred commitment, right?
He taught me Natuvanga. And there, that also helped, you know, be adavas, for instance, for me, when I was in my teens, they say, oh, ava abhinayam pandra nrutathle. It's not abhinaya. Joy can be expressed in different ways. And this I thank my masters for. See, this movement has a different feel to it. Or, you know, like this has a different feel to it. You know? I remember, or the Kulukinada, which he took me to Maithili, our Maithili, I think her name was, tall with a long plait. And he took me to her house in CIT Nagar. She walked up and down the balcony. He made her walk. And he made me walk behind her. And I was all of this size. And she was like this. And I also had a long plait. So it must have made for, I wish there had been a camera.
I know, right? Absolutely, yeah.
We never had smartphones.
Right.
But just to make me do that kulukinada. And the kulukinada, he wanted that because they never stood up and danced, you see.
Right.
And then sutra devu, there was K.R. Geeta in our class, who was, you know, she could just twist. And the sutra devu, they'd make us tight. And then he'd say, take a center party. Because tala mele. You know, our sutra adava goes like this above the head and then over the face, it's like a waterfall. It has to, you know, sutti and with force, it has to come down. This
beautiful
movement. So they used to focus on the tightness of the wrist when you did that. And turn it in front of the face. You know, it's amazing. Only when I taught my students, I realized how many mistakes are possible in this, because very often this is there, or I'd say, you know, if you come out like this, it's convex. It has to be concave, and at where it has to end. Some styles here, some style, ours would be right in the center here, So, points like that. So many things I remember when I think.
Ali, I'm just taking back two things. One is, what a privilege it is for me to see you dance like this up close and personal. So I'm really, really lucky. But also the beauty and the simplicity, but also the gravitas of the Tamil language. Hmm. I mean, in that little one word, it's able to pack in so much,
yes.
Right?
My mother, who was a great Tamil scholar, used to say it's such a terse language.
I know.
But you pack in what in English you would take.
Absolutely.
One paragraph.
You can just listening to you speak.
To
yeah.
Just maybe three words.
Right, and master spoke in Tamil.
Yes,
yeah?
of course. Yeah, our English is a question.
Right. So, Valli, finally, I just want to ask you a little bit about nostalgia.
You said rigor. You wanted to
yes,
talk
rigor.
About
Let's talk about rigor. I'm sorry, I seem to have missed that question. Rigor, sadhana. Hmm. Would rigor and sadhana, is that the equivalent?
English is a strange language. There are certain words which. Sadhana, for instance, you can't fully translate, I think, as rigor to me.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's much more than rigor. Rigor, to my mind, brings, the harshness,
yeah.
The hardness.
Yeah. The hard rigor work, to me the is, discipline.
It's rigor is something that is, implacable.
Mm.
Is the feeling I get.
Yeah, sure.
The
yeah.
Words have feelings.
Yeah.
Sadhana is not implacable, but it is uncompromising.
Hmm.
In that, it means giving of yourself 100. It's what my mother said was, give 100% of yourself and then some more. You have to keep pushing the limits of your capacity, individual capacity. It is not harshness, but you have to know what is your limit and then push against that. I used to say, and I tell my students the same thing, tired of. You can't stop at that point where you're tired and then say, okay, start again. No.
Mm.
When you push, Amma would say, கால் வலிக்குதுமா வலிக்குது பரவாயில்ல வலிக்கட்டும் லெட் இட் ஹர்ட் முடிய போகுது இட்ஸ் கோயிங் டு பிரேக் ஷீ சே ஐ வில் சீ இஃப் இட் பிரேக்ஸ் வி வில் சீ யூ புஷ் யூ சீ ஹவு ஃபார் யூ கேன் கோ
ரைட்
ஸோ இட்ஸ் ஆக்சுவலி சீயிங் ஹவு ஃபார் அண்ட் ஐ டியூரிங் பர்ஃபார்மன்ஸஸ் நாட் டியூரிங் பிஃபோர் பர்ஃபார்மன்ஸஸ் யூ நோ ஐ எம் நாட் அ ஃபிசிக்கலி ரொபஸ்ட் பர்சன் அண்ட் எவ்ரி ஒன் வெரி facilely would say, oh, what stamina you have. I always used to find that, how strong you are.
Mm.
Such strength.
Mm.
It's not strength. It is strength that is born of, it is endurance that is born of tremendous immersion and hard work. It is discipline of the mind, body, and the heart. Everything is committed to that. It is, and repetition.
Mm.
Practice is again and again and again. And Akhila, it is magical. I tell you that process of sadhana, of repeating something.
Mm.
When you do it with awareness, when you repeat again and again, you discover new facets. Dance is not fixed, which is why I said, it's not rigor, it's not something fixed, it's not implacable, because you're making discoveries all the time through that sadhana. It is sadhana is actually as much as it is discipline and focus and the process of all that. It is as much about growing.
So Valli, would you say that your a guru instills a sense of rigor in a student, but sadhana is what the student does.
It's a life process.
Yeah.
It is a process which is more than rigor. For me, does not convey what sadhana does. It's like saying nanam in Tamil.
Uh-huh.
You can't say shyness. It's much more than that. It involves so much more of a certain decorum, of a certain It doesn't mean lack of strength.
Mm. Mm.
It's an, you know, it's a quality which is so elusive, difficult to articulate exactly. So for me, sadhana is a much more multifaceted process.
Absolutely.
Of focus, immersion, of growth. All that happens with the sadhana, of expansion, of pushing your boundaries. Ultimately, it is also about, you know, the rigor that you're talking about. If it is for me, that word is a bit
limiting.
Limiting, and not just limiting. It's also, it makes me feel I'm the rigor of dance.
Yeah,
makes me think of being straitjacketed in some way.
Yeah,
for me, it's freedom. It's liberating. Mm. Sadhana liberates. Okay, let me put it like that. Sadhana liberates.
Fantastic.
Because it is through this repetition and focus and sadhana that you, when you dance, you are free. This gives you the ability to stop thinking and start being in the process of dance. You have to be.
Beautiful.
You have to be that dance, and that's not a cliche. I don't believe in mystifying and talking and using big terms. But it is being in that moment of the dance. It is becoming. It is becoming one, and sadhana makes it possible for you to be for that oneness.
Absolutely. So beautifully put, Valli. I just want to ask you this one last final question, really, about nostalgia. Mm-hmm. You know, when you talk about them, the world that was and the world that is, it's a bittersweet emotion, right?
Yeah.
And I'm sure that every time you dance and every time you're thinking about dance and you've, you know, yours is a life singularly like dedicated and devoted to dance. Do you think about them like so often and about how... you were privileged to have been part of this world, to have like imbibed from these amazing masters, and to be able to like transfer that knowledge to a future generation. Would you just be able to talk a little bit about then and now?
Then and now.
Yeah.
In the context of...
of your masters.
Masters, gurus. Mm. You said something about thinking about them often. Not a day passes, I think, when I do not think about my gurus or my mother, who's also a guru.
Of course.
So not a day passes when I do not think about them with the deepest gratitude, respect, and love. Because truly, they gave with love. I have done much good in many janmas to have merited these masters who, you know, they genuinely cared and they gave with true love. He was like, Subrai Pillai was like a father, Perivada was a grandfather to me. And then and now, but then and now with regard to them and what?
And the way, you know, like this transference of knowledge, Valli, we often talk about it,
yes.
Transmission of knowledge, right? It has really changed. And of course, we live in an entirely different world. You know, we're overstimulated.
It's a different era, yuga. Yeah. It's a different yuga.
Yeah, yeah. And that sort of, you know, osmosis that you talked about, I don't think it's even possible in the world that we are in. So
no, it's not possible because for osmosis, for that, they have to be repositories. Because when you are so deep and so rich, then just being with them, you absorb. There's a great deal that you absorb. Because it's not just about the dance. They might be talking about something totally different. He talking about rigor or about, you know, sadhana. Perivadhyar has often spoken about being with Meenakshi Sundaram Pillai, how, you know, in the village classes, and how, my God, that was scarily... the kind of what they demanded. You've heard Ravi Shankar Ji talking about how he was taught,
yeah.
and all the great masters when they taught, when it came to the art that was so much greater than you, that you could not be casual. That chalta hai attitude would not work. And it's not about impressing. It is not about seeking to impress.
Right.
It's not Instagrammable art that you are creating.
Right.
It is your, that is your path. That is a treasure that you're given. And it is your, it is what? It's like seeking the Holy Grail, or it's something, it's a quest. It's a quest. And you have to be, it's a sacred quest. So the point is, they taught like that. And those of us who have had masters like that, and I use the word master in the truest sense, or guru, who illumined our lives, we carry that in us. And I try, I mean, I wouldn't even presume to speak of myself in the same breath. My way of teaching is different. I have perforce to change. There is a lot more of spoon feeding that happens today. A lot more of analysis. I have used that analogy in the past of, you know, you make a road through a jungle. You're telling somebody about making, teaching them. You teach them about the process, the principles of laying the tiles or the bricks or the whatever, to dig, how to do it. And, you know, you say these are the dangers and these are the problems and you might face, level the road like this. But you just watch while that person actually does it, guide them occasionally. So then you are making the road, and in the process you're looking at the forest, and you're learning about trees, you're learning about birds, you're learning about insects, you're learning about the whole process of growth, the whole biodiversity of that place. Whereas what people like me do is we make the path to a great extent. I try to avoid it, but finally you end up, because of time constraints and
absolutely.
Things. Children don't have time to focus.
Yeah.
They have exams which are draconian, which they have this whole system of education which stultifies rather than in many schools.
Absolutely.
So if you're progressing down that path, you reach a goal, meaning that perhaps they learnt Abhinaya faster than I did. They learnt a piece, you know, particularly I teach them theatre and Abhinaya, you know, transitions from characters. And I go into so much more with my background. I teach them. We didn't get all that, but I discovered much more myself.
Absolutely.
So I think the learning process then and now is like that. That where we... And also, there is also YouTube, you forget, as a guru. Whether you like it or not, it is
Instagram
there.
Also, Vandana.
Instagram also as a guru. So, you have these other...
multiple gurus.
Not real gurus in a sense, because, you know, when you have this direct energy flowing between guru and sishya, I'm not saying going living with them, but just being in their presence. Which is why... Though I have tried, I do try to teach on, what's it, FaceTime and whatever. It's not the same for
Never
me.
Never the
it
same.
Cannot. What you imbibe and what you give, for want of anything better, COVID days have taught us that we need to adapt and
reimagine the way
we think.
No, for sure.
But that process of direct learning from the teacher who is committed, who is as committed as you are to you, to the process, and to not impressing but being in that moment. That I try. I hope I think my students do learn a lot, because their parents did say when I moved to this house, and Amma was also just very shortly before she passed away. And it was, we had our last school day in the old house in Lavanya, where all my happiest memories are vested in that house. And they said that, you know, we come to this class, to Deepasika, it's not just about classes and dance. It is a way of life, a way of thinking. And, you know, our children are so much richer. So that was the greatest reward.
No, absolutely.
So I think I was enriched. I am a better person today because of my masters. And I hope that when I get back to teaching, I had a long hiatus of 6 years now. I teach only my older students so far. Started with little ones.
Little
and
ones.
It's such a joy teaching little kids because there you are actually molding them in a way and giving them all these opportunities to open their minds and look out.
Right.
So I do want to start that again. And I do need, I cannot afford not to share. And that's why
Absolutely.
I'm thanking you because even stalking, it's only thanks to COVID. The one good thing was I came out of myself. I was very, very private, never could talk and was not comfortable with technology. It was thanks to COVID that you remember we, I think Picnic was the first who sort of pulled me out of my isolation.
Then
And then you did so many, you did on my mother, you did so many wonderful
absolutely.
Things.
Valli, but I just want to say that these are really precious gems. And I do hope that more people watch this video and really take away so much. Even for a non-dancer like me, I feel like so many things that you said, the idea of sadhana, the idea of absorption, observation, these are all such key insights to, you know.
I hope they will. Hope there is something that, something from this. Because, you know, I get the feeling sometimes that today that there is more expectation of concrete lessons. Of, you know, something concrete that you can take away. I don't know how concrete. I've spoken about what they've given me and what I have received and what I...
No, absolutely. But Valli, like you rightly said that, you know, if they are willing to, you know, like how you were willing
open
to like,
up.
Yeah, open up and also like listen to this conversation and reflect about their own dance or about anybody who's in a creative field, I think this interview is going to be very,
I
very
hope
useful.
I will, I'm not
thank
so.
You so much, Valli. So. And
but thank you for this. You know, you, I was talking, I remember about people who have done so much for me and you said, you know, co-travelers is a wonderful, because I was saying I want to talk about these people.
Absolutely.
We are not, dance is not a solo field. In conclusion, I just want to say that.
Absolutely.
It is not solo, meaning that we are solo dancers. And when we are in that space, we own that space. In a sense, we are part
for
of
sure.
that space.
Yeah.
We are not own, we are there. But there are so many people who play such a vital role from your gurus, your parents, whoever it might be, from musicians, from composers like Prema Ramamurthy. I hope we will be doing something.
I was just going to say that,
People, because without that, because dance is a holistic art and we need all this, so it is collaborative, whether you're doing a group performance or a solo performance, we can't be where we are without them and without friends, without journalists, without people to stimulate.
No, for sure.
You need that.
Yeah. So, today we use this word collaboration, collaborative, so, you know, almost as if we're just sort of being so great about it. But actually, I think this has been an intrinsic part of...
Your whole process, your life is a collaborative process. And that's why I'm so grateful to you and grateful to all these people. And it's my chance at this point in my life to express in some way, and now we have these means, to express what I owe them all.
Absolutely, Valli.
Thank you, Akila.
Thank you, Valli. I'm sure your masters are going to be smiling from wherever they are. And
I
you've
hope.
Been such an amazing student. So, so thank you for sharing these gems. And we look forward to doing more interviews with you about
there, because
all
there are
your...
so many people.
Yeah, so many co-travelers. So, we really hope to document them all. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.